Thank you, Junoon, for having me yet again, for all of you showing up on this Saturday evening. As you know, we're going to talk a bit about, you know, alternative spaces, and it's something that I've personally been very excited about over many, many years. And more recently, perhaps in the last 7 months or so, we've actually managed to, you know, after 35 years or whatever of doing theatre and dreaming about something like this, actually got our own little space in Aramnagar in Warsaw, and we run it really as an alternative space, you know. So I thought it might be interesting, you know, when this conversation came up about this talk, I thought it might be interesting to, you know, trace this whole business of alternative spaces. You probably are aware that, you know, in Mumbai itself and in many other cities, in the last 5-7 years, there's been a blossoming of little spaces. And we talk about it, some of us go and actually see shows, we enjoy it. But we perhaps don't know that this city has a very long tradition of alternative spaces. And I'm sure other cities do, but I'm going to talk really about Mumbai. And we need to kind of, you know, understand where we are and what defines this business of alternative space. What does it mean? Why do people do it? What are the impulses? So if you were to get into a very simple, you know, definition of alternative space within the context of the performing arts, it's really a space which is not a regular theater, right? It's not a regular auditorium. So it's alternative in that sense to that kind of formal space. But alternative also has many more meanings. What is it an alternative to? Are you responding, are you reacting to what perhaps is the mainstream, or in Hindi what we would call the mukhya dhara? Is it just functional? Throughout the last 60 years in Bombay, people have performed in different spaces because you couldn't get dates in the regular spaces. Is that enough to make that whole thing an alternative movement? I was just reading about this, and it's very interesting. Say in the 70s in the US, the whole notion of the alternative really came out of dissent, came out of increasing discomfort with the new face of corporate America, capitalism, the Vietnam War, and in the arts, for instance, it was a reaction against the late postmodernism in art, where they began to feel that art is also now becoming a commodity, a product, the way it's displayed in galleries, the way there's a huge market. So they said, well, let's break the formal spaces, go into areas that are warehouses, abandoned, disused spaces, and set up our art there. And art needn't be permanent. It might be there for 3 days and we destroy it. So, you know, and these were alternative spaces. So there are many impulses to alternative spaces. And I thought it might be interesting to examine the different examples of alternative spaces in the city and look at the different impulses, because each moment in history will have different reasons. Each of the players will have different reasons for doing this. Some of them profound, some of them very simple. So that's what I'm going to do today. It's really, in a sense, for me, an interesting tracing of my own journey to where we are at Studio Tamasha, because this is a history of 60 years, but I would say that in the last 30 years, I've been involved in it myself. So it's really a looking back and reflection on our own sort of work. Does that sound interesting, you think? Yeah? All right. Okay. So let's look at Mumbai. Mumbai, interestingly, has a very long theatre history. You know that this is a city that was established. It was established as a port city, essentially, by the British when they were given this island, and they got this island from the Portuguese. And it was the eastern seaboard of Mumbai is really a beautiful sheltered harbour. And that was the main thing, because the sea trade was very, very critical. So this are some images. This is the yacht club and, you know, the sea. And this is almost iconic in that sense. Oh, this is the computer. Mumbai, you know, was divided. This was the European areas, which would be around the Church Gate, Veer Nariman Road, Hanuman Circle. That was the European areas. They were very fancy, as you can see. Very beautiful imperial buildings, beautiful spaces, designed a kind of a gracious life. And then this is a wonderful image of the early inhabitants, the Koli or the islands, and who over time have slowly got marginalized. But what was interesting was that the port city attracted, and in fact the British encouraged a huge migration into Mumbai because they needed people to, you know, run the port city and be part of the activities and be part of the huge trade. So the native town started growing. And these are some old images of, you know, what now would be central Bombay. So you can immediately see the difference. It's kind of, you know, crowded. It's more, compared to today's Bombay, this looks wonderfully open. But, you know, relatively what you saw earlier, it's crowded, you know, narrow streets. A typical kind of Indian ethos of a city that's grown organically and perhaps even chaotically. Led to things like plague and, you know, all kinds of things were there. Some nice images of the kind of trade. Grain was a very big aspect of the trade. Cloth. Interesting migration of many, many different kind of communities. And this is an image of the old Lamington Road. Now, the reason it's up here is because really this is the area around which the first theater buildings were built in the city. Okay. The area, I would say, from Khetwadi, are you familiar with that part of Bombay? Khetwadi to Kamatipura, that was the stretch. Even if today you drive down that road, you will see the remnants. They are actually now the remnants of single screen cinemas, which earlier were in fact theater buildings. And this is really where the first theater buildings were established. This was supported both by the state and by private individuals. This was a period of very, very big merchant princes, you know, Jagannath Shankar Seth and some of the people from the Parsi community who were closely collaborating with the British in the opium trade. In fact, much of the wealth of the Tata Sons actually came from this time, tremendous sort of, you know, engagement in the opium trade. And it was a time of philanthropy, and there was a desire to grace the city with culture, with entertainment. So in fact, Jagannath Shankar Seth donated a piece of land in Grant Road to build a theater. So in 1846, the Grant Road Theater was formed, okay? Oil lamps and all that kind of thing. And you had a variety of plays happening there, Shakespearean plays, Indian mythological plays. But until 1853, most of the plays that happened in the Grant Road Theater, this is an old theater. Yeah, I'll just show you these images. This is, of course, a more recent picture made black and white to look archival, but it's really the building that's important. It's a single screen cinema, but this was a theater building at one point. This is the exterior of the Bhangwadi Theater, the famous Gujarati theater. This is, of course, you must be more familiar with this, Edward Theater, which still exists. But these were essentially the places where plays were done. And initially, they were mostly English plays done by local amateurs and touring companies. But I think it was in perhaps around 1853, 1856, that Vishnudas Bhave from Sangli comes to Bombay with a Marathi play for the first time and performs at the Grant Road Theatre, which was the bastion of, you know, colonial theatre, and he performs. And after that, with the combination of the Parsi theatre and the Marathi theatre, you find that English goes on the wane, all right? And it's these. And then you find local audiences getting involved, wonderful stories of how, you know, how the Britishers started, and of course the very upper class Parsis, who were very closely culturally aligned to the British, found it more and more difficult to rub shoulders with the masses. They tried to have separate seating. There was a lot of resistance. They had to give in. One of the excuses was that the turbans of the natives block our view of the stage. You know, so things like that. And so it's a very, very exciting period, very exciting period. And Parsi theater becomes hugely successful. And they work in Hindustani and in Gujarati. And large commercial enterprises, they start touring the company. And in fact, they culturally set the style for a kind of theater, a mix of music, dance, great storytelling. They took liberally from Shakespeare, from Indian mythology. And this kind of sets it up. And a lot of the influences that you see in the later theater in Mumbai, and then of course subsequently the influence spread far and wide, comes really from this combination that the Parsi theater created. Post-independence, so this was really, I'm setting this up only to give you an idea that there was a flourishing theater scene in this city. Multilingual, large audiences, wonderful stories about Bhangwadi. You know, I was fortunate that when I started working in the theater in the 70s, some of our performances actually happened in the Bhangwadi theater. We didn't do Bhangwadi style plays, we did contemporary Gujarati plays, but Bhangwadi was a venue where you got an audience, so we used to go and perform there. And Bhangwadi was a mix of music, dance, you know, painted curtains, and there used to be special trains that came to Bombay from Ahmedabad, from Surat, which were Bhangwadi trains. So people would come in the morning, spend the day here, watch a play, and then go back the next morning. It was that popular, all right? So this is really, so Bombay has been very fertile in terms of its theater life. And post-independence, things begin to change. You know, by then, all this has kind of waned, and the arrival of, see, the Parsis logically moved, because of the commercial nature of the enterprise, logically moved to cinema, right? Because that's where the money was, that's where the interest was. And slowly, the same buildings start getting converted into single-screen cinema. We call them single-screen now, but they just became cinema, including our famous opera house. And by then, the theaters had spread beyond just Grant Road, right? So the success of the Parsi theater, in fact, leads to its kind of decline once cinema comes in. So post-independence, I think the most significant experiment, and I don't think it was very well thought through, but it, as often happens with these things, things just happen because the right people are at the right place at the right time. There is, we're talking about the late 50s, early 60s, you know, an air of idealism in the country. There is a whole big desire to rediscover our own cultural roots. There is also a desire to understand the larger world, to connect to the larger world, and to contemporize ourselves and our practice. And a very interesting thing happened. There was a very famous lawyer, Gujarati lawyer, who was very much part of the freedom struggle, Bhulabhai Desai. And I'll read a little bit, and I'm going to now for the next 10 minutes refer to this book. It's a very interesting book, Scenes We Made. It's an oral history of experimental theater in Mumbai. So Bhulabhai Desai was a lawyer, freedom fighter, and a congressman who was born in Gujarat but practiced in Mumbai. After his death on May 6, 1946, his daughter-in-law, Madhuri Ben Desai, an art historian and author of several books on ancient culture, put his immense wealth to use by converting one of the two buildings that stood on his property into the Bhulabhai Desai Memorial Institute. The institute stood on Warden Road in South Mumbai. The road was later renamed after Bhulabhai Desai, so that's Bhulabhai Desai Marg. It was a sprawling ground plus one bungalow with a big garden where sculptures and ceramic works were kept. Studio space was given to artists like Gaitonde, Nalini Malani, Nasreen Mohammadi, Ambalal, Tayyab Mehta, M.F. Hussain at rupees one a month. Ibrahim Alkazi ran his theatre unit from an office here. Vijaya Mehta and Satyadev Dubey rehearsed their plays here, and someone called Ravi Shankar established his music school, Kinara, here in 1962, right? Now, can you imagine this amazing space? So this is modern-day Warden Road. This is one of the little studios given to a painter, right? Just to give you an idea of the kind of thing. And let me just read a few kind of, you know, memories of the place from people who actually were there at that time. This is Kusum Haider, a very well-known actress at that time. The atmosphere at the institute was unique, a kind of golden age with all the arts coming together with people engaged in a genuine quest for artistic expression. It was a period of flowering, intense activity and complete focus. People were very modest and self-effacing without any ego problems. There was a certain kind of innocence. Art, music, dance, and theater intermingled as nowhere else that I know. There were hardly any rivalries or gossip. These were earnest, fresh, and innocent days. Of course, you know, looking back, nostalgia makes it seem a little rosy because we do know that there were a lot of internal politics within Bhulabhai Desai. In fact, there was a young tribal painter who was employed as a peon, but he one day started carving a piece of wood and he was brilliant. And you know, some of the artists didn't particularly like the fact that someone who's a peon went on to have an independent exhibition. So all that kind of stuff happened there. But read, I mean, you know, use a filter, but you'll get an idea of what it was like. She goes on, my deep interest in contemporary Indian art today is due to my relationship with artists and interaction with people like Hussain, Tayyab Mehta and Gaitonde, who left a permanent mark on me. There were other people at Al-Qazi's school, Cedric and Rohini Santos and the Dacunias were all supporters of theatre unit, etc. And she names a lot of very, very interesting people. Great plays like Media, that's Euripides, Hedda Gabler, Ibsen, The Father, Strindberg, Yerma, Lorca, Saint Joan, Jean Anouilh, Murder in the Cathedral, Eliot. So you're seeing a lot of very, very interesting classics being performed there. I had parts in Macbeth, Antigone and Euripides. I played two of the lead roles. For the performance of the father, Soli Batliwala, who ran the place, presented 100 rupees for the production. So this is Kusum Haider who talks about it. Mr. Benegal, Shyam Benegal, the filmmaker, used to live in Hyderabad in those days, but he came often to Bombay at that time. And in fact, he talks about his first experience seeing a contemporary dance workshop at the Bhulabhai Desai Institute and how it completely opened his mind. But he talks, he says, besides the artists who work at Bhulabhai Desai Memorial Institute, they were all the people who visited for lectures and discussions and so on. That was quite something. We haven't had a repetition of that ever. Today, you can't get artists together in one place like that. It was something very unique that happened to Bombay at that time, right? So you get a sense of, and the impact it has is something that's really interesting. Girish Karnad, the playwright, again, you know, used to be in Dharwad, and he used to visit Bombay, and he had a very close friend, Ashok Kulkarni, in Bombay, and the minute he hit Bombay, get off the train, and they would go and watch plays. So they watched a lot of Marathi plays. When one day someone told them about this place called Bhulabhai, they landed up there, and that's when he saw Al-Qazi's work for the first time, because Al-Qazi used to work out of Bhulabhai. And Girish was actually quite blown by what he saw. Let me just tell you in his own words. Al-Qazi's contribution to our understanding of theatre was immense. From where I came, the tradition I had known was of natak companies performing in proscenium theatres. And I told you, there's already a long history of proscenium theatres. Then in Bombay, Ashok Kulkarni and I saw a lot of Marathi plays, you know, Katyar, Kalza, Kujli, and a whole lot of Marathi plays which were musical and successful. But theatre was really opened out to us by Al-Qazi, particularly his productions like Miss Julie, Antigone and Euripides. It was not just how he used the space. There were all kinds of things that baffled me about these plays. All right, I think the most important thing was that these plays demonstrated to him, and they were performed at Bhulabhai, not in a formal space. They were performed on the lawn, they were performed on the terrace. So suddenly, theater was freed from the sitting room, from, you know, the home set, four walls, a window, chairs, sofas. It suddenly became possible to play a play in space and not in a specific room, which is a very small reductive idea. It opened it out, and this had a huge influence on him. I think Al-Qazi's contribution to our work was not where it took us, but where it took us away from. The dominating figure those days was George Bernard Shaw. So a modern play meant a living room. In the Marathi or the Kannada version, a sofa and two chairs and a servant dusting the furniture and then answering the phone and delivering all the necessary information was its reflection. This was absolutely derivative of George Bernard Shaw. That was modern theatre to us. And Al-Qazi took it away. He said, no, that's not it. The great advantage to us was that he looked to Europe, leaving England aside. He did Hedda Gabler. He was interested in European playwrights and their plays, particularly with female actors. That was a complete education for us in theater, right? So you get a sense of what that space was doing, all right? Now, one of the people there was also a young theater person who'd come to Bombay from Bilaspur and got into Al-Qazi's group, coming from the Hindi belt, though he had studied literature in St. Xavier's College and, you know, quite well read. And very aspirational in that way. He wanted to be part of the urban elite, and English was a way in. was Satyadev Dubey, and he was working with Alkazi, much junior to him, in that company theatre unit, but already banging on the door to be let in, you know. So there was a tremendous rivalry. Alkazi admired him, was very, very appreciative of his work, but he also knew that this was the guy who could kind of, you know, take his position. So he talks about his experience, and I'm reading this to give you an example of how a space like Bhulabhai Desai, and I think you get an idea of what was going on there, how a space like that actually then starts triggering off things that which continue beyond the space itself, right? And that's the power of that. And I'm not even going to get into what the musicians did there and the dancers did there. I'm talking really about theatre. So Dubey had started directing plays in Hindi at that time. And one day, this very, very, you know, wonderful looking gentleman with glasses comes there and looks around, and you know, he doesn't know who to ask for help. So Dubey says, "What are you looking for? Can I help you?" So he said, "We have heard about Alkazi and the theatre unit, so we came just wanting to know more." So Dubey's associate Shakur Bhai says, "But we also do Hindi plays. Why didn't you come and see our play? It's on tomorrow." It happened that this gentleman was Dharamveer Bharti, young writer in those days, who goes on to become one of the colossus and legends with his play Andha Yug. And he happened to, you know, walk in there, curious. So they agreed, they were staying close by, they agreed to come, and Sapne was done. And they were shocked because there was no front curtain or anything. And Dharamveer Bharti came backstage and congratulated Dubey and said, "This is the first time I'm seeing a play without a curtain in front and all that sort of thing." By that time, I had read Andha Yug, Dharamveer Bharti's Andha Yug. So I said, "Bhartiji, please give me the rights of Andha Yug. I want to do it." So he said, "Sure, you want to do it? Take it. The rights are yours." That's how I did Andha Yug. But I must tell you where. So Alkazi had already accepted the offer of the Sangeet Natak Academy to head the National School of Drama in Delhi, you know. So Alkazi's actually main career happens there. There was a farewell party for him. People were worried about what was going to happen to theatre unit after him. Alkazi, in his parting speech, said, "Why are people worried about the theatre unit? Satyadev Dubey has already started a new play, right? And he will take over." Later on, I said to Alkazi, "Why don't..." Later on, Alkazi said to Dubey, "Why don't you do Andha Yug?" And Dubey said, "Alkazi, I want your terrace. Will you allow me your terrace?" At that time, his flat was vacant, and I was using the flat, sleeping over there, and doing all my recordings there. And that's how I did Andha Yug on Alkazi's terrace. Okay, now, this may seem simple, but that production of Andha Yug, which was staged on the terrace, and I'll show you some pictures, you'll get an idea of what I was saying. These are some plays that were done at that time. That's Kusum Haider, in fact. That's Zul Velani. And you'll see immediately how different. See the kind of abstraction that is being used. Some of the plays that were rehearsed at Bhulabhai then went also performed in other theatres. This is Eurydice. So this is Alkazi himself. That's Girish Karnad. And that's the young Dubey. And that's perhaps what Bhartiji looked like when he went and talked to Dubey. So this is Kulsum Terrace. It's a more contemporary photograph, so it's quite messy. And on the terrace of this building, Andha Yug was done. And people who have witnessed this performance cannot stop talking about it even 50 years later, 45 years later. It was an amazing thing. They had used the water tank. People were on top of the water tank. They were below. There was the sound of the wind, you know, and they had actors with powerful voices. It was quite an experience. Just show you some images. These are not from the terrace production. Unfortunately, perhaps the Alkazi archive has pictures, but I was unable to get hold of them. But that's a young Dubey there. And that's Amrish Puri out there. The point I'm trying to make here is that here you have a Bhulabhai Desai type space where you have a whole bunch of artists from practitioners from different forms living together, working together, cheek by jowl. Even if you wanted to avoid, you couldn't help mixing with dancers, entering into conversation with painters, with the puppeteer. And you have this amazing space and this amazing atmosphere where there's this kind of cross-fertilization, okay? And everybody is feeding off the other. And it has to lead to something interesting. And And this experiment, I think, Andha Yug, and this goes down in theatre history as one of those amazing things. Bharatiji, when he saw this, I mean, when he writes this amazing, you know, first-person account of how he was so nervous about what would happen to his play. He stood at the bottom there, you know, and he could hear the actors' voices coming across. The city must have been more silent in those days, of course. And he was trembling with anxiety about what would happen to his play. But when people came down, they were just gaga. So this is one of those classic things. So whatever the reason Bhulabhai Desai Memorial Institute was set up, right, and of course because, you know, the person who Madhuri Bain was an art historian herself and person of the arts, there must have been a desire to do this. But it sets off things, right? And Girish Karnad goes ahead to write some of his major works deeply influenced by it. Dubey starts his career there and sets a completely new trend in theatre. Many of those painters go on to become India's leading painters, right? Dancers, musicians. So you can see the importance of a space like that. And that truly is perhaps the first example of a thought-through, organized alternative space in this city. Bhulabhai Desai didn't last very long. At some point, they were not making money. They probably didn't have funds, whatever, I don't know. But they sold the land to a builder, and a multi-story building came up there, and that was the end of the Bhulabhai Desai experiment, right? Big loss. But, you know, that's how it is. You just move on. The next place that I consider really important, and it's not really a formal performance space, and I will, you know, stretch the definition of the alternative, but this was a space that nurtured a lot of theatre work, experimentation, discussion, and an art scene, and functioned very, very deliberately as a space that was an alternative to the mainstream. Okay, and this is a place called Walchand Terrace. This building still stands in Tardev. It's bang opposite the mall. Walchand Terrace was owned by the family, the Doshis, who went on to run Premier Automobiles and, you know, that kind of thing. And there's an interesting story to this. The chief, you know, actor in this, the Walchand story, continues to be Dubey, because, you know, Dubey played a very, very major role in the experimental theater. And so, you know, after a production, as all production, after every show, you always have a party. And there was a party, and at the party, he was introduced to Vinod Doshi and his wife, Sharuyu. She was an art historian. And they were, you know, they liked to see themselves as patrons of the arts. They actively supported, you know, they were very active in the theater scene. And so, Vinod asked Dubey, "Tell me, what can I do for you?" I said, "Vinod, give me rehearsal space. That's what I really need." So Vinod instinctively, because he was always overgenerous, offered me his own flat. But I didn't want to intrude into somebody's house. So I said, "People will find it difficult to come to this place and also awkward to rehearse in such a lovely place." So then he offered me Walchand Terrace. Walchand Terrace was at that time vacant. We got the keys, and of course, we were supposed to switch off the lights and fans, which we never did. But one of the things about Walchand Terrace was that it was supposed to be also used by Avishkar, which is a theatre company run by Sulubha and Arvind Deshpande, which had just started. It had been given jointly to Arvind Deshpande and me. So here was this rehearsal space, but Arvind's actors began to find it difficult to come to this place in Tardev. So he didn't use the place much, and I had full freedom to use it. We also misused it. We used to have our drunken parties and all that here. But the most unique thing was the number of people who would come there. Actually, most writers like Mohan Rakesh, Badal Sarkar, for them it was like a dharamshala. They would come and stay there and have a drink, and we would be talking late into the night since we were not disturbing any neighbors. This place was like an open house. One of the rules was stub your cigarettes on the floor, because the next morning or the same night, all the actors would clean the floor. That was a very important ritual. Right? So those who you know, who work in the theater know how important it is to have a space like this where you can shout and argue and fight loudly, where you can drink and you can stub cigarettes on the floor, right? The necessary ingredients to make a play. Yeah, So Walchan Terrace now goes on to become the center, all right? And some of the most amazing productions in Marathi and in Gujarati and in Hindi get plotted, planned and rehearsed here, all right? Amol Palekar, yeah, was a very, very much part of this. That's Dubey, that's Vinod Doshi and that's Shariv Babu. It's not from that period, it's much later, but this was the only picture I could get of the three of them together. Yeah. This is a diagram of Walchan Terrace drawn by Amol Palekar for us. All right, this is how it was. It was a large hall. The main part was for rehearsals, right? This little room on top became Dubey's bedroom. When there were visitors, they would be entertained in the room at the bottom here so that they didn't disturb the rehearsal. But people who have used this place say that it was surrounded by, you know, there were bedrolls that were kind of put against the walls so that at night, nobody just went home, they just stayed there. So they opened the beds, slept there, you know, woke up the next day, went to work. Because those days, most people had day jobs. So they went to work and they came right back there in the evening. So let me just read to you a little bit. From 6 in the evening onwards, different things would be happening in different corners of Walchan Terrace. There would be poetry readings, play readings, and discussions about them on a regular basis. Theatre writers, directors, actors from all over the country would drop in there, and we got the opportunity of listening to their ideas and opinions. Pratibha Agarwal, Mohan Rakesh, Shamanand Jalan were some of the great theatre people from outside Bombay who often spent time at Walchan Terrace. A charmed theatre atmosphere was created there, and as we soaked it in, our horizons expanded. The other great advantage of Walchan Terrace was that the finest literary minds would often frequent it. One day, while we were rehearsing for the Marathi translation of Pagla Ghoda, a Bengali play by Badal Sarkar, Khanolkar dropped in. He sat watching our rehearsal. When we broke for tea, I confessed to him that there was a small nursery rhyme in the play which I had been unable to translate into Marathi. He said, "How does it go?" I recited it for him and explained its significance in the play. I also told him what depth of meaning Badal Da had suggested through the rhyme. Then he said, "Recite it again, will you?" The original Bengali. I did. Then he said, "Recite it again." In this way, he made me recite it 5 or 6 times. Then he said, "Give me a piece of paper." He took the paper, drew out his pen, and translated the rhyme at one go. What an amazing translation it was. He hadn't merely got the sense of it, but the rhythm, the meter, everything. Only a man of Khanolkar's genius could have done something like that. "How wonderful this is," I said. To which he said, "Glad you liked it." Put his pen back in his pocket and left. These were the many small gifts that made Walchan Terrace culturally such an important space. Right? And then I have to read you something from Girish Karnad, because he was a regular visitor here. It's always interesting to hear legends in their formative years, right? And how vulnerable they were, right? So Walchan Terrace was a very important place for me. For those 4.5 years, it was like going back to school again. Everything was happening here. Someone was fighting, Dubey was shouting, someone was rehearsing, people were falling in love, people were falling out of love, getting married. Everything was happening simultaneously. Actually, my most vivid memory of it is arguing intensely with Vijay Tendulkar one evening, both of us quite solidly drunk and then falling asleep. When I woke up the next morning and looked to my side, there was no Tendulkar. I looked to the other side and there was Badal Sarkar. And I thought, "God, I've had too much to drink last night." But apparently, Badal Da had come by some train at 2 o'clock in the morning and turned up here. These 4 years were just extraordinary and came at the right time. Right? Isn't it amazing? It gives me, you know, goosebumps just thinking about this, right? I mean, you know, you can again put on the filter and put things aside to nostalgia, but you can get a sense of the spirit, right? Again, Walchan Terrace began at a rehearsal space and goes on to become, you know, a space that is so beautifully nurturing of artistic work, right? With all its faults and flaws. So this is Dubey directing his fantastic production of Aadhe Adhure at Walchan Terrace in one corner. That's Amrish Puri in the foreground. That's Puri Saab and Deepa Lagu, a young Deepa Lagu, also in the same play. There's Dubey yelling at his actors as he was very fond of doing. A very intense moment from the Puri Saab is looking very concerned at this lady, Sakhar Dande, I think she was, who he wonders if she's going to be able to take all that intensity. So this is what happens at Valchan, right? And of course, inevitably, the day came when the property within the Doshi family was divided, and it went to one of the other brothers, and Vinod lost control of it, and you know, Valchan Terrace came to an end. So it's around this time that I started working in the theatre when Valchan Terrace was open and was shut down. And I remember my first few years with Dubey was really him looking for spaces to perform. So he had a, you know, for theatre people, performing in a space where you can perform without busting the bank and, you know, without the economical and affordable is really critical, because a play is a living thing. If you don't perform it, it dies. It survives only in performance. And if you can't perform a play enough, you know, there's a great deep sense of frustration. So he had deals with Tejpal. I've seen my first... No, it was a rehearsal space, and then they went out. So some of the productions, like Sakaram Binder was done there and went out and performed in the regular theatres. Gidhade was done there, went out and performed commercially. But it was really a space where the new theatre was forming, the new sensibilities were forming, you know. And also it was central. You know, Bombay was not so big at that time, so the centre was in the south. Then it shifted to Dadar, then it shifted to Bandra, and now perhaps it shifted, you know, Malad or wherever. So the centre keeps shifting of the city. So that's why I said it's not technically an alternative performance space, but it's an alternative space to what is happening around you, okay. So like Dubey's theatre unit, because Dubey took over theatre unit, there was also another very interesting group that worked in Marathi called Avishkar, Arvind Deshpande and Sulabha Deshpande, and you know, they were part of a much larger group called Rangayan. They broke away because they had artistic differences, and they wanted to do a different kind of theatre. And especially in the Marathi scene, the dominance of the commercial theatre was so complete that it was very difficult to do anything that was not part of that style. And they were looking for spaces to perform. And Sulabha Tai, you know, she worked as a school teacher. And she worked in the Chabildas Girls' School. And next door was the Chabildas Boys' School, which is, this is the Chabildas Boys' School. And her brother, I think, worked here. And they knew that this school had an assembly hall on the third floor, I think it was, or the second floor. You know, one of these third floors. And it had this old roof, a kind of a sloping roof, very high ceiling. So they went to the school management and said, can we use this place in the evenings for our theatre work? And, you know, in the 70s, people were much more open to these things, I guess. And they had a bit of a reputation also for being serious theatre people. And the school said, go right ahead, use it. So up they go, and it's a big, big, big hall, you know, just stone floors, flagstones, you know, windows on both sides, chawls on one side, the school ground on the other side, in the heart of Dadar, literally a 5-minute walk from Dadar railway station on the western side. Very crowded in the evenings, right in the middle of the throbbing life of Dadar. And they said, you know, we won't be able to use this space completely on our own. We don't do that much work. Why don't we share it with other theatre people? So there were about 7 or 8 other theatre companies that worked at that time, doing similar kind of, you know, non-mainstream, non-commercial work. And they said, you know, you're welcome to come and use this space. The rents were nothing, all right? Tickets were 5 rupees and 10 rupees, right? And about 7 or 8 theatre companies started using this. And word spread that Chabildas School, the Chabildas School Hall, was an open, welcoming space for people who wanted to try something different. It was a space that you could use. It was completely affordable. And if you work consistently and you know, with faith and rigor, then audiences were coming to watch plays. And over the next, I would say, 8 to 10 years, which was really the golden period, if you want to call it, of Chabildas, it became a very, very important space for theatre. I think for a lot of us, it was for the first time we realized that we were part of a pan-Indian theatre. that we didn't, you know, till then you worked in Maharashtra, they worked in Bengal, somebody worked somewhere else. It seemed all fragmented. But because at Chabildas, there were translations, adaptations from different languages, there were other groups that came and performed, you really felt that you belonged to a national theatre community, a very important thing. And some amazing experiments took place in form, in writing, and it really becomes a very, very important part of Mumbai's theatre history. So it starts off really as a kind of an alternative space, very, very supportive. And let me just read out a little bit about this. So this is Kakde. Now let me just show you some images first. So this is the street, right? The gentleman right in the middle is Arvind Deshpande. To his right is Surabhatai. This, and there's a frowning Dubey up there with his arms folded. This is a photograph from Shantata Court Saluai. This is the cast. That's Surabhatai. Maybe 3-4 years before she passed on. That's Kakde Kaka, who, amazing manager who has kept Avishkar alive for years, and he was very much, and I'm going to read something from him. So this is what the hall looked like from the, this is again a sketch done by Amol Palekar, interestingly. Right, this is the corridor outside. So Kakde Kaka says, when we started Chabildas, we saw it simply as an effort to create an opportunity for all those who wished to participate in the movement to come together. We had noticed that there was a lot of theatre activity happening in pockets all over the city. We felt this needed to be channelized. That is why we decided to open the space to all. But it was easier said than done. There were a lot of fights over dates. Everybody wanted weekends. Those who got Thursdays would get very annoyed. On Thursday evenings, families watched the popular film music show Chhaya Geet, because by then the monster of television had arrived, right? People living around Chabildas would switch it on exactly at the time our show started. We would have to shut all the windows to keep the sound of the film music out. And there was supposed to be a dip in the audience on Thursday evening because everybody sat at home and watched Chhaya Geet, right? He goes on to say, let me just find it. We opened the space with C.T. Khanolkar's Pratima. The cast comprised of Dr. Lagu, Amol Palekar, Deepa Lagu, and Sulubha Deshpande. Then when Jaydev Hatangadi came from the National School of Drama, he performed Changuna, the English, the Marathi translation of Lorca's Yerma. Dubeji performed Hevadan, Girish Karnad, with Amol Palekar, Amrish Puri, Sunila Pradhan, and Bapu Kamerkar in the cast. We did Sari Rath, which is a Badal Sarkar play. Dubeji performed Aure Garbo, which is a Mahesh Ilkunchwar play. They also did a Bengali play in translation, Achha Ek Bar, or Bahurupi performed Raja Sa Khel, play by Vrindavan Dandavate, directed by Dilip Kolhatkar, and Unmesh, that is Achut Vaze's group, then the younger writers, Itzalde Bopla. So these were the groups that performed in Chabildas during the first year. Once people realized that they could do work of this sort there, the groups grew in number and a new strong current of plays began. We did a lot of plays in the beginning, but gradually, very gradually, the number of shows decreased. Every movement has its ups and downs, besides which there were other reasons. First, the consistency and force with which new writing was done once subsided. Second, as new opportunities beckoned, people went away and the groups disintegrated. But we always welcomed new groups. We made sure the place was open to whoever wanted to perform. We were criticized for it. People said, anything and everything goes at Chabildas. There is no quality control. But we felt that new theatre people with no experience needed to be given that experience. How were they to grow otherwise? Okay, and this is a question that, you know, always is a big question when you run a space. How do you curate it? How do you do, right? So Chabildas goes on to become really part of theatre history, national theatre history. By the time it reached its prime, there was, you know, plays happening in different languages. So this is a sense of the hall. So you performed on the floor. It was a makeshift hall. It was created at 6:30 and then it was dismantled by the time the show ended. Stone floor, as you can see, quite you know, bare, right? Quite bare. This was what theatre looked like in those days, in the, you know. Sometimes they put up sets and made it look like this. That's Amrish Puri and Sunila Pradhan in Sari Rath. That's Puri Saab, Dube, Sunila Pradhan, and a little me in Garbo, Mahesh Ilkunchwar's. Yeah. This is Dube's production of Shankar Shesh's Mayavi Sarovar. This is Udhwas Dharmshala with Dr. Lagu playing Professor Kulkarni. And that window is a Chabildas window. It's not part of the set, right? That's a Chabildas window. It's kept shut so that you don't have film music coming in. Hot as hell. We often had two costumes, one before interval and one in the interval, because you would be soaked with sweat. No air conditioning, fans, noisy fans, street noises coming in. That's Nasiruddin Shah and Ratna Pathak Shah in Dawn 1 in Hell, I think. They also performed at Chabildas. And this is a play, my first play that I directed called Aada Chautal. That's Sunila Pradhan and that's me when I was leaner and fitter. Yeah. So, now let me see what I have here. What did Chabildas mean for two different people? I have a number three somewhere. Yeah. Shafat Khan, writer who actually really started writing regularly at that time. He says, Chabildas was important for a new writer because it put no constraints on how he wrote or presented his plays. The long established platform for new writing was, of course, the state competitions. But what constrained us was the fixed running time of plays to make them eligible, and the motivation of winning prizes is what pushed us. For our generation, therefore, Chabildas provided an important space. Equally important was the fact that the audience came there to see unconventional plays. The new writer had the benefit of this ready-made audience, right? And this is a very important thing. I'd like you to keep this in mind, that the minute you have an alternative space, the audience is already half prepared to see something different. So you're not going to go into a Chabildas expecting to see a Shivaji Mandir play. You're not going to come to a Studio Tamasha expecting to see a Prithvi play. You know, you're already half prepared, and that makes our work that much easier. Mahesh Elkunchwa says, when he came to Chabildas, he was very blown. He said that Chabildas, when he came from Nagpur, at Chabildas, the immediacy of the experience, the intimacy of the experience was very strong. One felt like a part of what was happening in the play. Witnessing theatre almost felt like a religious act, a sacred act. What I also loved was that people who mattered to me would devotedly come to Chabildas to see what was happening there. For example, Adya Rangacharya, the playwright from Karnataka would come. Shripu Bhagwat, Elkunchwa's publisher, was another such person. So I was happy that I was part of this happening, bustling scene. Little quote from Ratna. The energy of the people who performed there was truly infectious. We shared a sense of being pioneers. I don't even remember thinking how I was going to make a living out of it. Perhaps we were particularly stupid. It was like something will turn up, and we carried on from thing to thing to thing. Not to have any kind of safety net liberated us. It made it possible for us to do whatever we wanted, and that's fortunately something we have been able to hold on to over the years. Chabildas was very much the bedrock on which freedom was constructed for a whole generation of us, right? And I'm not even going to read from Nasir, I mean, because, you know, he came from the National School of Drama where they had everything, and he came to this bare place and he was horrified. And he said, you can't do theater here. And his first impressions were very, very negative. And slowly he understood the spirit of the place. And I think the fact that he continues doing theater today is largely because of the spirit he imbibed at Chabildas. He says it in his own words. So there is a sense that, you know, Chabildas is always talked about as a large movement and that kind of thing. But Rajiv Naik, who's a, you know, theatre writer himself and academician, and his theatre company did a lot of very interesting work at Chabildas. He was actually the new generation of theatre makers at Chabildas. And he says that when we speak of Chabildas, we tend to add the word movement to it. We call it the Chabildas theatre movement. I think we should get rid of this notion, because Chabildas was always an activity, never a movement. Take any definition of the word movement, right? It needs purpose, aim, direction, takeoff point, clarity of purpose. None of these applied to, nor could apply to, what happened at Chabildas. Perhaps this worked to the advantage of the theatre. Had it been framed by a program, theatre would not have grown every which way that it did in that space, right? So, you know, there are negatives and there are positives, but he chooses to warn us, which is, I think, is timely. You know, we do tend to make more out of Chabildas than it perhaps was. So Chabildas ran for about 15 years, and interesting time in India's, you know, social and political life. Liberalization had set in, consumerism had set in. people were no more interested in climbing three stories, steep staircases to a hot place to watch a play. The energy of the alternative theatre movement was also waning. People would say they do absurdist plays for the sake of absurdism. We don't understand it. TV was weaning away large audiences. And inevitably, Chavidas slowly died out. Very sad, because it had a lingering death. It had a lingering death. Then finally, the school management threw Avishkar out. They said, no, we don't want you. So that was almost like the ultimate blow, you know. And today, it's a marriage hall. I've been there 3 years ago, and it's ghastly what they've done there. It's destroyed, all right? You were there recently, and you've seen it. It's nothing like what it was. The spirit has left the place. After that, there are interesting things. I mean, you know, if you look at it, there have been continuous... People need these spaces. People and they come up. Okay, so this is a group of, well, Malayalam-speaking people at BARC, really inspired by a playwright and a writer. This is their production of Andha Yug at Anushakti Nagar. You know, yeah, this is something that I stumbled upon while talking to Ramu. And it became, okay, the production must have been very amateurish, but they were looking at new spaces, something. And from what I gather, it had become a place for them to meet and talk and discuss and produce stuff. Maybe one or two performances, no more than that. This rather filmy picture is actually my representation of a discotheque on Marine Drive called Studio 29. Okay, discotheque run by Sabira Merchant and her family. And evenings... It's free before the disco starts. What happened? It's kind of free. So Alec Padamsi says, why can't we use it for play readings, right? And before your disco comes on, and she says, okay. And before you know it, I think we need to cue it. I can't do it. And before you know it, you know, theater is happening there. I was talking to Naushil Mehta the other day. Manoj Shah and Naushil Mehta are well-known people in the Gujarati theater. And they did a play called Atyare out there at Studio 29, which was a play set in a cafe, right? And I asked them, I said, why did you do, what is the reason why you did Atyare at Studio 29? They said, yaar, kahin dates nahi mil rahe the for this kind of play. And it's stupid to do a play set in a cafe in a regular theater. It doesn't make sense. So we said, let's do it. And, you know, being shrewd business guys, you know, whatever it is, you're doing experimental work, but they did 50 performances at Studio 29, right? 50 performances. Because it was a discotheque, they were able to serve alcohol. So they got a whiskey sponsor who gave them bottles of whiskey free, which they sold to the audience, right? 50 performances. Praveen Joshi, who was the star of Gujarati theatre, his plays in the regular theatres, the top ticket was 30 rupees. Studio 29 was 35 rupees. All right? So that sets off. And this continued. A lot of people did. I've seen performances at Studio 29. I couldn't get any image of Studio 29, for, unfortunately. And Naushil was unable to help me. Some years later, some of us who were doing theatre at that time, stumbled upon this space in Andheri, the Young Women's Christian Association. The lady who had designed their hostel building, the architect, I bumped into her one day and she said, you know, you should go down and see the space that I've designed. It was an old bungalow in Andheri and there was a well outside and we constructed this big building and I put a slab on the well and I said, this looks interesting. So I put some seats around it and you should go and see it. So we went there and we said, wow, there was a little amphitheater with a stage, you know. And we talked to the authorities, and of course, they were very cagey, being a women's hostel, only between this time and this time, but they actually gave it to us, and we had to pay them. And we ran this experiment of a neighborhood performance space for about 6 months. LIC gave us 20,000 rupees for 6 months, and we would have a jhola collection, and that collection would go to the group. So this is a performance of Sudama Ke Chawal with Kumud Mishra in the part there. This is what it looked like. And 60, 70 people would show up every Sunday. We had no social media, so we got people to volunteer from the audience to put up posters in their housing societies around. Because we believed that a neighborhood space, people would from the neighborhood come. Over the years, we realized that's a myth. But, you know, people would come and we would watch there. So this went on for about, 6 months. This is Kolaba Woods. Vikram Kapadia has done performances of his play here. This is a kind of composite that I've created, Naval Dockyard. Pearl did a production here, big open-air production here. The Tempest was performed in a bandstand, around the bandstand at Atha Banda. A little later, the Industrial Theatre Company, run by Pushan Kriplani and Rehan Engineer, did some very interesting work in alternative spaces like this. This is an art gallery performance. You can see immediately how interesting and how different it looks. You know, so they were into, you know, using, they were using video and stuff much before it became, you know, fashionable here. Very interesting work. And they always looked for non-traditional spaces to perform. This is the Kama Hall near Lion Gate, and this is Pushan Kriplani's production of Hevadan. It's a theatre company that I'm particularly fond of because they did some amazing work. So you can see how they've converted a hall into, you know, you can see the, it's very exciting with the audience sitting in the round. And then, of course, you know, Sanjana with Prithvi tried very hard to get the Hanuman Circle garden going as an alternative performance space. This is an image of our production being set up at the Hanuman Circle garden. Very interesting to see it in daylight setting up and then at night once it's on. You know, just magical, that space. This is the Land's End Theatre at Bandstand in Bandra. It's a kind of a beautiful amphitheatre. The sea as a backdrop. And this is the same play being performed there. So we became really good at fitting our plays into alternative spaces. But one of the things that I'd like to point out, that there were many experiments. People look for spaces, people perform very interesting things. But to me, in my mind, a key element that defines the validity of a space is how much can you sustain it, right? One-off experiments are valuable in their own way, but in my mind, if a space has to be defined and accepted and recognized as an alternative space of significance, then it needs to exist over a period of time and create a body of work. Okay, it shouldn't be a one-off. Many of these experiments were one-offs. They were very exciting to watch, but they didn't lead to anything. They didn't lead to anything. This is a poster for my play, Cotton 56 Polyester 84. It was shut down by the police in Nagpur in a large, you know, auditorium of about 1,200 seats. They banned the performance, and there was a large audience that came up, and they were very disappointed. So we went to a neighboring hall, and those three people standing are actors. So in that little space, they performed the whole play for these people. All right? It was one of those very interesting evenings where space became, you know, of no consequence at all. It was the experience and the magic of theatre. And I put this slide in only to tell you that this is what happens in spaces like this. All right. So now to come to a slightly more personal thing. I think we're running a little short of time. Yeah, are we okay? Yeah, well, I'll try. So personally, and this is where it comes now to, so you guys get a sense of where, you know, this kind of large canvas that we are dealing with. So in my own work, what was happening is that my plays were growing in size, the scale was growing, and I was doing big productions, you know, Club Desire, and Mere Piya Gaye Rangoon, and, you know, Stories in a Song. Big, relatively big. Huh? I mean, I don't mean they were Broadway shows, you know, but big, and, you know, where you needed big sets, and, you know, this is Mere Piya Gaye Rangoon at the Globe. You can't get, you know, more exciting than that. Okay, so it was, all this was happening, and I kept feeling a great sense of being a little disconnected with something very, very important. Disconnected with an audience, because what happens in these large spaces is that the audience sits in the dark, they watch a show, and then the lights come on and they go home. And we don't know who they were, they don't know who we were. Even in a place like Prithvi, that happens. You can spot your friends, but vast majority you don't know. The bigger your production, the more the stakes, the higher the stakes are. You can't be terribly spontaneous. Everything is planned. Everything, because, you know, it has to be planned. Dates are planned, performances are planned. You know your program for the next 1 year. You can't respond. You just do the same thing. You get a bit trapped by the logistics of it. Also a great feeling that, you know, how does one in a way connect with younger talent? again, a big production, you can maximum have one or two young actors. You always need skilled actors to carry it off. But there are a lot of young people who want to get into theatre. And a feeling that, yeah, theatre is not just about performance, you know. It's so easy to get trapped in that, that what do you do theatre? So what do you do in your theatre? We perform, we make plays, okay? Having been through this history of theatre, being influenced by stories of Bhulabhai Desai or Walchan, having lived through the Chabildas times, and also belonging to a theatre that is a thinking theatre. All the people I worked with were very, very thinking people. It just seemed very foolish to narrow the definition of theatre to just performance. The other thing was the discomfort with how insular we are and how inward we are looking, as a community. We hardly open ourselves out to other things, to other, you know, how many of us actually read? How many of us go and watch, see art exhibitions, listen to dancers, listen to academics? We live in a small world. And this has been something that was kind of, really bugging me. And so there seemed to be a time about 3 years ago when it was important to break out of this legacy, this large, big company legacy, and try something different. So with a group of young people, we decided to set up a new theatre company called Tamasha Theatre. And one of the intents was not to perform in regular theatre spaces at all. We would only perform in non-regular theatre spaces where we could build audiences, where we could talk to audiences, we could see them, we could have a completely different relationship with audiences, and where it allowed us to do work that was more centered around ideas and less worry about what the show looks like, how you mounted it, right? It was a place where we wanted to provoke people, to challenge people, to stimulate discussion and that kind of thing. And it seemed possible only in an alternative space. So for about, kind of long story short, yeah, this is what Tamasha looks like. Small spaces, big ideas. So we start with, you know, we start with plays. We start looking around for, you know, empty halls. This is a place called Avenue 29 in Santa Cruz. It's just an empty hall. And initially we started building a theater in the space. So you can see, this is how we created a kind of, you know, this is a little kitchenette where actors would sort of sit and put up chairs and you have an audience and, you know, large numbers of people come, right? And then we lost that space. We were invited to the aerobics floor of a gym to see if we could do something. And this was what it looked like. And we said, oh, maybe we can convert this into a theater space. So on weekends when they weren't, you know, panting and sweating there, we would actually create a theater space there. Audience seating, yeah, use the foyer for a reception area, and people would come and watch plays. Yeah, it was fun. And then we did a production called Blank Page, which we had to open in an art gallery as part of the Kala Ghoda Arts Festival. And for the first time, we said, let's use the space and not impose our theater into it, our design into it. And so Blank Page, in a way, liberated us, right? And it's really with this play that we start now thinking about what we want to do with the theatre. So, for instance, you see this. Blank Page is a show of contemporary Indian poetry performed in 4 or 5 different languages. And after the show, the audience gets a copy of all the texts that we perform, which they can take home. We encourage conversations, feedback, detailed mailing lists so that people come again, keep in touch with audiences. Always make sure that after a show, you're always with them, right? Then a period of looking for other theater spaces. This is a bar in Parel, makeshift, yeah, performing there. People after the show never go, they always wait. This is a badminton court in FTII converted into, during their strike, converted into a theater space for us when we performed for the students, the striking students. This is the Prince of Wales Museum, the Chhatrapati Shivaji Vastu Sangrale, where we performed Blank Page again, right? This is another bar. This is a bookshop in Bangalore. Somebody's office, or the IFA office in Bangalore, right? A bookshop in town, Kitab Khana, I think, where we used to be part of Junoon's Mumbai Locals. Before the main talk, we would squeeze in and do a small performance. This is M-Cube Library. We did a lot of work where we partnered with, you know, spaces and one of our only thing was that we would say, give us at least 6 months. Don't throw us out before 6 months is over, because we needed that time to build an audience, right? We were very, very put. And on the experience of the one-offs had told us. But we felt, yeah, that now it's time. We want to do more than just the play. We want to do other programs. This is actually a readings program of Marathi theater scripts that we read for 6 months in this very same space. And on a Friday afternoon at 4 o'clock, 20, 25 people would come and listen to actors reading out. You know, this is it. You can recognize the room. It's a lot of people watching, right? These are actor jams, young actors, you know, showcasing their work to peers. We also run a program with cancer children and use a lot of young actors who perform, you know, with the children, for them, right? So we were doing all this and we said, we need our own space. Okay, this was not born out of some desire to be owner, space owner. It was born out of a desire to be able to control your space and do it, program it the way it needs to be done. To create a space which was tangible, which people could say that they could come to on an ongoing basis, and we should have a personality and an identity which was just not for Saturday, Sunday evenings, but through the year. So we went looking, we tried first in this fancy building in BKC. Someone offered us a space there and they said, create a theater for us here. This is the lobby of this building, right? It's almost like a cathedral. And we said, okay, we'll create a pop-up theater here. We made very interesting designs inspired by origami, right? So the idea was that Friday night, this would be assembled. And Saturday when the employees came to the buildings, oops, there's a theater in a foyer. And Saturday evening and Sunday we would perform. And then Sunday night, it would be dismantled, stored, Monday morning, back to business, right? Very exciting idea. We spent almost a year working on this idea. Unfortunately, it didn't happen. Yeah, so this is how we had designed it, actually. Very interesting. It's all self-supporting origami. Finally, we went to Aram Nagar 2. A bit of a come down from BKC, but definitely more alive and more organic. Aram Nagar 2 is an area, for those who are unfamiliar, it's the heart of the casting industry in Bombay, right? The casting, the film people. It's a strange thing. It's caught up in time. It's a time warp because of it being government land, collector's land. No redevelopment has taken place. There are these shack-like bungalows there that were used to house refugees. Earlier, the army barracks were there, and then refugees after the partition. And they remain there. And they just, you know, little lanes, trees. You feel like you're not in Bombay at all. So we hired this bungalow. We couldn't afford it, but we hired it. And this is what we found when we went there. A courtyard. We said, wow, a courtyard. And a large 400 square foot room. A little transition space. A backyard. And we started working on it. We said, this is where our dream space is going to be. And we got some planning done. These are some of the things. We had 1 month to set it up, you know. And a lot of work went into it. We wanted, of course, to have green rooms. So we have two small cubicles. And this was the opening. And this is what it currently looks at. It's a lovely space where you can sit outside. You know, we have audiences watching. We can seat about 50 people there. This is a screening of something or the other. But it's a place where performances happen. This is Sanjukta Wag performing there. This is Rajeshri Sawant performing her show here. This is a program where we invite researchers to present the outcome of their research in cultural areas. This is a program of readings of Urdu short stories. Very popular program, as you can see from the turnout. It's just short stories that I read out. This is music, live music. This was a South African performance poet who happened to be passing through. But because we owned the space, we said, okay, are you free tomorrow morning? He said, yes, we'll come and perform. And about 15 people came, watched him. He had a great time. It was amazing for us to have somebody just walk through. So, you know, this is a series of contemporary dance, German dance. We're doing a series where we're trying to understand the evolution of contemporary dance through the German experience. And this is Rishikesh Pawar, who's a choreographer dancer from Pune. He comes specially every time to introduce this because he studied dance in Germany and he knows that very well. So he talks. It's a kind of a guided program. We watch this. And yeah, people kind of hanging out. So these are some of the posters. This is, you know, this is Searching Cultures. This is our South African poet. This is one of our plays. Yeah. So, in a sense, I think all the learnings and all the understandings and all the yearnings of the years and years of, you know, reading about alternative spaces, thinking about them, trying to understand what each space meant at a particular time in history, in a sense, is what we have poured into this particular space. It's a heavy baggage for a small space. It's, you know, great aspirations for a small space. It's a big burden, but we are trying. And it's very interesting that, well, I would say it's about 4 or 5 years since we started doing this, not at Studio Tamasha, but this whole, in these 5 years, there's been a proliferation of small spaces in the city. Not just in Mumbai, we have performed in Bangalore, in Delhi, in Chennai. Recently, I was reading about Hyderabad. Everywhere, every city in this country, little spaces are coming up and people are performing and people are coming to watch performances. And this is a very interesting social phenomenon. And I think this requires some thinking about that with the growth and with the dominance of the mainstream, there will always be people who say, no, we want something else. We want to, we don't believe that everything has to be homogenized, to be dumbed down. We want to be provoked. We want to sit and be with fellow human beings, watch something, talk about it, experience that. It's really very difficult for me to explain the kind of joy that people get from something as simple as that. 25 people sit in a room, watch something that is very stimulating, enjoy it, talk about it, have a cup of tea, go home. That's it. It's really not much. And the mainstream spaces are unable to do this, right? And they can't, perhaps. They can't. They're a different model. It's these spaces that allow you to do this. And I think they're really vital for any civil society. Okay? These are little islands of sanity, little islands where you can go and recharge yourself. And if you're lucky and if you are thoughtful and if you have vision, then this could be, you know, kickoff points for better things to come, as we have seen from history. I don't know what we will be able to do with Studio Tamasha, whether we'll be able to last another year, because, you know, it's very difficult financially and economically. And we refuse to be caught up in this trap of, you know, the arts have to sustain themselves. You know, if banks can't sustain themselves, why the hell should art sustain themselves, right? I mean, if we didn't bail out banks or the big corporations, half our economic system would collapse. You and I are supporting this entire system, right, through our hard-earned money. So why should the arts sustain themselves? So what does that mean? It means looking for support. We don't go to corporates. I don't believe in corporate support. We look for support through individuals, not just monetary support, but support as a community. I think we are about to embark on very exciting times. It's good that small spaces and owners of small spaces have figured out that you can also make money there. It's good. I think it's good. I really will never scoff at the commercial aspect because it allows spaces to survive. So there are some small spaces which are sheer, just commercial, you know, propositions, which is fine as long as they're available for you to perform at a reasonable price. But at Studio Tamasha, we try to go a little beyond that. We just don't think of them as a space to perform, but a space where you can dream, where you can get stimulated and excited, and maybe a vision of the future. So this is where I'd like to stop. Yeah? Thank you. I'm sure if there are questions, we can talk about it. Yeah. Thank you. I know. No, I perfectly understand if nobody has anything to say. Yes.
Like, you described the phase of, like, it was a phase of storytelling.
It was a phase of?
Like, people, actors and everyone they were telling stories, you know, like, through their performances. They were interacting. There was a different kind of interaction at that time. As you said, Walsh and Terrace and all. So, do you think that can be recreated or something of that can sort of still be done in the spaces we are finding right now, like the small spaces, the big spaces, anywhere?
Yeah, well, you know, I don't understand the first part of your question, but I think one has to be a little careful. what worked in the 70s and the 80s may not necessarily work in the same form today.
Exactly.
Okay. Theater making arts practices changed dramatically from then to now. You know, the objective realities are completely different. I think it's possible to recreate the spirit of it. Okay.
Right.
You may not be able to create the same form, but I think the spirit is possible. And it can happen. I mean, it can happen. I do wish we had a bigger space which allowed for more off time. Okay. A space where you can come when you have nothing to do. So you can just come, have a cup of tea and find somebody interesting and chat. But you know, Prithvi Cafe used to be like that at one time. You just landed up there and you took a chance and somebody you might meet or you might not meet. But if you met someone, you would have an exciting 1 hour conversation and you could go home. You need spaces like that. And I think places like Valchand, Bhulabhai Memorial, and even though Chhavildas was given only between 6 and, you know, 10:30 or so in the evening, the footpath outside the school, where there were a couple of benches that the watchmen used, became actually a place where they would just gather and chat, and then all the bars around Chhavildas were places where you finished a performance and the conversation continued. Okay, so I think that's really critical. You need spaces where you can meet, where you can talk and feel safe. That's really important.
Yeah. So do you think any of that sort of spaces exist in
Bombay? Yeah, they come and they go. As I said, Prithvi Cafe came and it's unfortunately gone because it's been completely taken over by, you know, it's being used as a cafe now by young people because it's reasonable, it's attractive, it's very reasonably priced. Also, theatre people in Mumbai are terribly busy making work, selling work, you know, trying to make a living. I think if there's an attractive space, they might just take pauses and come. Yeah, I think it's possible. But things have changed. Things have changed, yeah.
Sunil, because you've lived through that, I mean, you've grown in theatre through the troubles last time, right? And now you're working with a today's generation of theatres, or generations, but you're working with, like you said, Tamasha Theatre is younger,
yeah,
theatre wallahs.
Yeah.
And for me, I think part of context is, of course, the environment, money, all of these things, the physical things of environment. But part of it is also what is our social culture today. So when you talk about times when you evoke those images of Girish Karnad dropping into Valchand Terrace and Badalda there and whatever, it's also an era where time our experience of time
was very different.
Was very different.
Absolutely, that's what I said.
In your space in Studio Tamasha, how are you thinking of today's, you know, how people handle things in general, and
yeah,
how do you think of making that space or creating that discourse space? I mean, how does it? I don't know if I'm being clear on that question, but I'm trying to understand how you're reacting environmentally in creating that space for people.
Well, you know, one of the small disappointments has been, well, one of the things that we have discovered after starting this space is a whole other world of theatre makers who we didn't even know existed. Or we knew they existed, but they were more or less invisible to us. There's this little small companies that perform here, there, you know, 3-4 shows, and they never will ever get into a Prithvi, never will ever get into an NCPA. Some of them are extremely resentful because they think they deserve to get in there and they will not, or they can't, etc. And they perform there. And, you know, Studio Tamasha is a space that is automatically attractive to them because it's cheap, and it's, you know, it's got more facilities than many other places. And, you know, we are there all the time, and I'm there most of the time. And, you know, I'm sitting right there in front of them. And I do wonder sometimes. I'm curious, so I peep in and watch the rehearsals and get a sense of what they're doing. But very often, I don't see any curiosity from their side. If I was working in the theatre as a young person, and I knew that there were, you know, senior theatre people around who are smiling and saying hi, good morning and that, I would just latch on and I would make sure that I got something out of it. And that's how we learned our theatre, really, you know. We didn't go to school. So I don't know what it is. There is a sense of entitlement also. Maybe there is a sense of inaccessibility. I don't know what it is. So that two-way process that I hoped would happen has not really happened. partly it could be something that we are doing wrong, but partly I think a lot of people don't think they need it, you know. It's also seeing your work as a product. They very often say, you know, our work is content driven. Now, that language is not a language of art. It's a language of commerce, right? We have many products, sir, you know, and so it's also a different language. It's also a different thing. So it's a learning process here. But some of the more theatre-based, theatre practice-based practitioners, say someone like a Manish Chaudhary, doesn't do much of theatre, but he is very much part of a long theatre tradition. He spends a great amount of time there, and he will just make sure the minute I'm going from one point to another, we'll sit and have a conversation. And he's developed a lot of work there. So I think, as you just pointed out a little while ago, that it's still too early for it to be that. You know, it's still too early. It will take a while before people feel that they want a space like that. That this is a space that is actually available to them to do nothing. It's not a space that I will rent and perform. It's also a place where I can go and hang out. And that will take a while, I think. Yes, Avinash.
Presentation, I didn't find mention of
No, not on purpose at all. There are many spaces, like you didn't also find mention of Avishkar's Mahim School. Okay, that's very much part of what happened after Chabildas. Not possible to fit in everything, but yes, Bharati Vidya Bhavan was an important thing in its own time when, you know, Girish Bhai ran it. Of course, very much so. But there are many other examples also which I could not cover in such a short time. But I really do feel that this requires a real proper study. You know, I really wish a theatre academician or somebody who writes about theatre history actually did this, because Mumbai has an amazing story, as you all seen. It's an amazing story. You know, it's 60 years of, you know, this kind of theatre practice. It's very interesting. Very interesting. And very few of us know that we're really part of this kind of history, na? We all think that we have invented Hive and we invented Cuckoo Club and Studio Tamasha. No, yeah, it's been happening, you know, and people have done it for different reasons, but essentially with the same spirit.
What also strikes me in what you've shared is the collaborative, there's so much giving and taking, which is not, I don't think it's common for cities across the country from the little bit I know about
history. Mumbai has been very lucky here. Even today, with all the narrowing of our work and our worlds, and there is still a theatre fraternity. I remember sitting in Prithvi Cafe and we were talking about how can, you know, some of us get together and create a fund which would allow younger theatre makers to at least seed money to start a production. Okay, so I know that X is a wonderful, has the potential of being a good director, has everything that has, but doesn't have that 20,000 rupees to get it going. And there were friends sitting from Delhi, I think it was Sudhan, and he says, you know, I cannot even imagine a conversation like this happening in Delhi. So we are that way quite lucky, you know, that we've had a bit of a fraternity. And the times that I'm talking about, it's a very strong fraternity, very strong. They fought with each other, they attacked each other, but they eventually all worked together towards, yeah. Also, there were simpler times, Samira. Now times are much more complex, much more complex. If you did 20 shows of a play, that was great. Today we do 100 and we don't even think about it. You know? So it's a different time. All right.
There's a question here.
As you said, there is an audience which want something else or different.
Yeah.
So it is a fact.
Yeah.
But my question is that what is the reason behind this? Because the number of these audience comparatively low.
Yeah.
The reason behind it is a community culture or a mainstream domination. How can we increase this number of audience?
So why are you here this evening? You could be watching Judua or something.
Yeah.
Why? Right? Actually, it's a question. No, I'm not making a joke. I really believe that. This is exactly what I'm talking about. See, we should not worry about numbers too much. Right? We should not worry about that. That's again falling into another trap. Okay, it's the TRP trap. Let's not get caught up in the TRP trap. There are things that are going to be mainstream and there are things that are going to be non-mainstream. And we have to accept that we are going to always exist a bit on the fringe. But we can, but we hope that we will make some kind of an impact. There was a time, for instance, in Marathi theatre where the experimental theatre really stimulated the commercial theatre. A play that was popular on the experimental circuit, the idea was picked up, and the same year there was a commercial version of it, and it did very well. And so experimental theatre constantly gave new blood in terms of talent, new ideas, etc. That did happen. Now there is hardly any experimental theatre to talk about in Marathi, which is a huge problem. But so, you know, whatever it is. So I think we are always going to address smaller numbers of people. That's an inevitability. I don't think that should become a disappointment. It just means that we have to work harder and do much more so that over time that small number actually becomes a large number. So, you know, 50 into 100 is a lot of people. Okay, so we just have to do that. I'm hoping that this proliferation will also lead to many more spaces, and hence in one day, you know, if you look at the listings of the Bombay Times, the free theatre listings on Friday, anytime now, they're dominated by alternative spaces. You'll find five or six in the regular theatres. Baki, it's the Cuckoo Club, it's Clap, it's Studio Tamasha, it's whole lot, Brewbot, now there's Overact. You know, in Aramnagar in the last 3 months, there are three new spaces opened. And all of them, things are happening. And everywhere people go. It's not as though ki teen log aaye the. People are going. So there is something happening, na? Right? There is something happening. And I think we should just hold on to that. Yeah, how much TV can you watch, yaar? We all know that, na? Kitna pagal hoega. You know, people want to step out, hai na?
Not for cinema only, but as a community. Mostly people run through a mainstream. But hardly people come out for the different.
Yeah. I think a lot of people don't know. You know, aisa nahi hai ke, a lot of people don't know. So if we were able to say, for example, if we were to produce things and build a network where we could perform every day across the city in smaller spaces, I think the people would come perhaps a bit warily for the first time. But if you are good at what we do, and if you're honest in what we do, I think we will be able to develop a much larger audience. We are also a little cut off, no, in that sense. We are also a little cut off. It's not easy, huh? Our society does not value the arts. Forget the state. Because we've had it too easy. In this country, art has happened on its own forever. Wherever you turn, there is art. We take it for granted. When people from outside come and they say, you know, it's amazing, we don't see this. Our societies are sterile in comparison. So we take it for granted. So we don't believe that art needs support. And when I say support, I don't mean in a patronage way or, you know, jagir de do usko, not that kind of thing. Society has to value it, yeah? We are right now just fighting some kind of a battle for some strange reason of our own, you know? I mean, Junoon is absolutely, it's just craziness, yeah? Who would do this? This is ridiculous. You know, who would do it?
Have there been any spaces you've come across and said, I wish I could perform here as an alternative space?
Many spaces, yeah. I think one of the first things that strikes any, at least theatre people who are interested in this, is you walk in and you first say, hey, you think I can perform here? No? You think I can rehearse here? No? Okay, maybe I can have an adda here. You know, you're always, yeah. So there have been spaces that are, you know, you would feel very much you want. There are some wonderful, you know, if you walk around the NCPA complex, for instance, the inside spaces are dreadful, but the outside spaces are fantastic. Those walls and those nooks and crannies, and, you know, you can create wonderful things there. The roof of the Tata Theatre is amazing. Inside it's terrible, but on top it's amazing. We don't have access to that. We can only dream. But yeah. I think it started raining. Yeah. No? Alright, so for those of you who are interested, do come visit, watch shows at Studio Tamasha. It's fun. Lots of things happen.